Hey y'all, it's Katherine, and you're listening to the Gladder to Hear That podcast. Today, I'll be talking about what creativity has meant to me, what it can mean for others, and what a slight shift in my mindset about it did for me. So without further ado, sometimes it's about having the next cool-looking product, app, or design. Sometimes it's about having the creativity to use your desk space in the best way possible, or having the creativity to store your hair tools in an old cookie tin because it just works and it costs you nothing, i.e. the I quote unquote knew I was saving that for some reason unquote moments, and not just the cookie tin but the tools I'm storing in it. It's a small example that when I realized it in my life, it was super helpful. I was like, I have so much more space in my bathroom. It was great. I always feel like we always want something earth-shattering when it comes to our creativity. Maybe we want the next great invention or business, and that's great. But maybe it starts with having the creativity to know where to find the education you need to start the business on the cheap, or having the creativity to sell someone on the idea of being your business partner. Maybe you want to come up with the perfect creative gift for someone special in your life. But maybe it starts with making a little post-it note of their hobbies and how they fit in with yours so that you can plan something for the two of you to enjoy together. And maybe it's about creative shopping and knowing that you don't have the skills to make your own clothes, but you can go to the thrift store, cut up some items to tailor a piece to your own creativity, or a budget-friendly version of a designer piece, for instance. Sometimes it's about making do with the resources that you have or can get for free, seeing where you can go with that, and then being able to make an educated purchase. That said, it may be the case that you're more creative than you think. There may be others who can hardly believe what they've seen you come up with. Like, other people are probably shocked that you were able to do something that they have no idea how to do. You may think it's normal to describe your style, being able to find the right words, whereas your friends might find your knowledge of interior design adjectives, of all things, helpful, insightful, and, well, accurate. You may think your art is basic, quote-unquote, but to someone who has struggled with drawing simple things, it's really pretty, and it's something they wish they could do, perhaps. You may think your abilities, even in a given sport, may still seem rudimentary, but someone else wouldn't even know how to use the equipment, like, at all. Like, they'd probably use the wrong end of a hockey stick or something just because it hasn't been a part of their life. That's a simple example, but it could go into almost any sport, really. That and, like, youth groups use things wrong a lot, though. That's actually a funny story in my life where we had to have the creativity to use a soccer ball as kind of like a soccer ball, except combined with Gaga ball. If anyone's a camp kid, they know that it's where you only hit it with your hands. And so for youth group activity once, we used a soccer ball as not quite a handball, but we could only use our hands instead of only our feet. Things you do in youth ministry, it's great. I digress. I also realize that sports may be something that not many people associate with creativity. But when it comes to new plays and strategies, I'm ready to think there's creativity in that. Creativity can be about thinking of a new way to go about something, a new solution, a helpful hint, really anything original. And that comes from me looking up the dictionary definition of creativity because I was like, there's so much applied to this word. What is it actually about? And it kind of does center around that word of original. Obviously more to that. But I don't feel like quoting the dictionary. Not so glamorous creativity can also be very literal. Someone working in a messy job probably needs a certain level of creativity to work most effectively. So maybe A, they don't get as messy with the project as they could, or so they're at least more organized or more effective with how they go about it. Take a bakery, for example. It's flowery and it's a lot of hot air from the ovens and whatnot and all that, but it takes a lot of creativity to tweak recipes, ingredient amounts, and everything that goes into making something that people really like and that's profitable. That's practical, and that you can make it on the right schedule even. Like, all those different elements have to be put together in the right way, and that's creative, among other words that don't come to mind right this second. It's insightful, too. Take a sales job. It takes a lot of creativity to craft the perfect email to send to prospects, or to develop your phone call scripts to speak, or your on-call general questions. It takes a lot of creativity to figure out how you're going to communicate best to each individual person that's on the other end of that line. How you can best do almost any office job. Figuring out the best way to get your job done. In all honesty, that's what most people are and what most people bring to their jobs. The knowledge to do it to a certain extent, that is, but also learning along the way how to make your creativity and your knowledge and your education, whatnot, work together to make the best work of your job and to make it work best for the specific company or organization or whatever that you're applying it to, work or hobby or whatever, or volunteer opportunity or whatnot. Or take school, for instance. If you're still in school, the amount of creativity you have to come up with for any class is really absurd. I remember taking various English classes, and I was expected to come up with a story off the top of my head. I know nothing's really changed in school in that regard, but also like to come up with a satirical essay concept or figuring out a new way to analyze the same book that like hundreds of other kids were writing essays about. And I know mine weren't as unique as they could have been in many regards, but I still think that's worth talking about. So students, don't lose your creativity. And in other subjects, I think this really applies to is politics and social studies as well. Again, you're going to be writing about the same kind of stuff people have been writing about for years and years in school because it's history. And it's still good and it's still valuable to learn and to put pen to paper or fingers to keyboard. But like when they say to use your own words, there's so many memes on the internet about that, but it's so true. You kind of do have to find your own words in order to learn it a lot, but that doesn't make it any more easy. Oh, goodness. So many papers I wrote that I'm remembering. Or if you're a teacher, where was I? As well as thinking about the best way you can learn a subject. So for students again, and what you can personally take from each teacher, no matter where you're at in school, and with online learning as well. Now, that said, I got to choose when I did online learning, but it takes a lot of creativity to organize your life around your education, how you're going to take classes, in what order, how you've learned to apply things, what you already know, and be able to translate it into papers. Like, that shouldn't go unnoticed. Teachers have to have a lot of creativity to write test after test after essay question after essay question after presentation after class of teaching often the same lecture, which gets old, but you still need creativity somehow. A lot of balance. But don't let the way you have to change how you learn in life and how you process information between teachers or for teachers between different students who learn differently go unnoticed. It goes both ways. Both parties in that regard deserve a certain amount of credit for what they're having to process, come up with, and understand. Especially since, if we're honest, everyone is kind of a teacher and a student for their entire life. I've learned that through different friends being teachers to different groups of people, myself having to teach junior hires when I got a business major in college. Now, it's not very often, but it still applies the point. Anyway, creativity looks different for different people in like every respect. I know that may be obvious to others and not so obvious to other people, but I think it's important to think about, as I mentioned, all the different cases I can think of so far. It's interesting to think about where creativity takes us in life, and having to realize that some things you have to have the creativity and know-how for may not even exist yet. Like, growing up, I saw that my sister could paint and draw quite a bit better than I could at that point. What I didn't realize is that I would enjoy writing, but not in the academic sense as much, and that I'd like writing for videos, making videos, taking different photos, modeling, and even writing and producing a podcast, not to be too cheesy, but to use an applicable example. Like, you may need to be waiting until a different art form comes along, in all reality. Then you might not know what you're even best at yet, no matter your age. Yes, some people are blessed at knowing that they are world-class violinists from a very young age, or an Olympian from the time they're 5 and on the tumble mat at a gymnastics gym. But you may need to take lessons from a family member or a YouTuber or go to school for it. Maybe if you want to get into piano, you have to play at church and you'll learn that everyone either loves it or may tell you you're not as good, but then you can learn from that. Or you can see that everyone likes singing along to your piano playing, and that can be satisfying too. And everyone can see a lot of creativity in that, I would argue. Or maybe you need a partner for your creativity. Like, you could write an amazing speech, but you might need someone to speak it because that's not your skill set. Or you're really good at having the right cadence, the right tone, the right inflection, all that goes into speaking, anything. But you're not a great writer. Or maybe you are. I don't know. Maybe you're blessed in both those areas and that's your thing. Or maybe it's about seeing a character a friend drew that you could write a children's story for, or having drawn something and your friend says, "Hey, I got a story idea for you based on that character." Or, "Hey, could you draw this?" If you're the writer talking to your artistic friend, or your friend who has drawing skills, I should say. Like, that you have to see a lot in another person and in their skills, and you have to know your own skills or maybe you don't and you just think of something. It's really interesting how creativity comes along to me. Maybe you can be an on-camera personality for a YouTube channel and your friend is a really good editor and doesn't mind spending hours in front of a computer screen. Or maybe you know how to a super fun swing dance move, but you need a literal partner to actually put it into practice and learn it. Not an easy way to get around that one, if I'm honest. Maybe it's even about having the creativity to know what you need to major in school, or having the decision-making ability to know that you shouldn't go to school, but that you could be a stellar cabinet maker or electrician or specialize in another technical field. Like, there are so many fields that take a lot of learning, but to know that you have the skill and ability to learn that takes a lot of decision-making skills and analysis, or perhaps trial and error. golly, I hope not, but because that doesn't sound fun to me. But more power to you, I suppose. Or into research into what that kind of person does, if it does just pique your interest, and knowing what you're getting into, hopefully. maybe it's about realizing that you took a carpentry class in about cabinet making, but you're kind of more of a real life Ron Swanson and you want to make furniture instead. Slightly different application, I would argue, but it's still a lot of the same skills, I think. I don't do carpentry. That's okay. Or maybe it's about making lighting displays and programming lighting for conferences, even though you took a basic electrician course at community college. You can take ideas like well-known concepts, like the tech fields, and turn them on their heads for a different use that no one has ever thought of. That, or you could simply fill a gap in the skills market with your talents, knowledge, and yes, again, creativity. Maybe it's about combining passions you're good at. You love sales, you love antiques, you like shopping. There's a chance you could use the ability to flip old stuff you like that you see from the past at estate sales and then go sell it. Takes a lot of skill to know when you should buy something, if you have the knowledge to clean it up without damaging it, if you could find the right buyer at the right price point at the right time. Do you have the storage? If you can't, you might be able to find in the right product, but maybe nothing else lines up. Or maybe you want it for yourself and you can still get creative and make it work for yourself. Maybe you still might not know, but that takes a lot of personal processing, for lack of a better word, to acknowledge that and be okay with that. Not as much creativity on that one, but still a lot of critical thinking. Not a guarantee, but we've gotten over that in the podcast before anyway. You might be able to find the right potential opportunity. You never know. So I challenge you to think about your skills, how you personally use them, what new things you could try to see if you have the talents for that you may not realize. Ask others what unique paths they've taken and where it's brought them. For me, one creative element in my life that I've gotten a lot of joy from, especially in the past couple years, is from combining some of my favorite things, like buying old school records to dance to on a modern dance floor, so to speak, like at weddings. Well, I should say knowing that music to know how to dance more in a way I enjoy at weddings I go to. Incorporating old school style pieces into my wardrobe next to the more modern elements I also love. Same thing goes for my home. I love challenging myself to make what I can get for low cost fit into my mid-century modern aesthetic. Even as I say that, I want to note that there's more of a comma between mid-century and modern than people might think, for me at least. See, you can buy mid-century couches or furniture almost no problem. But I take older furniture, often not mid-century old though, and make it work with my genuine antiques as well as my more modern technology and decorating sometimes. If you think you have to spend a lot to reach your perfect aesthetic, think again. Although I may not have the perfect wardrobe, nor high fashion one, nor the most luxury, so to speak, apartment, I force myself to be creative about what and where I buy, what I keep, and what I combine. That said, thanks for tuning in to Gladder to Hear That with me, your host, Katherine Gladder. And if you like the show, please give it a follow and subscribe. Thanks again.